assemble, and it was unfortunate that the crew's driver had been the last one to arrive, wasting further precious minutes. Whilst unloading their equipment the night before, they had looked on as the police officers unsuccessfully attempted to restrain the head of the family nearby. George saw his arm was bleeding profusely from where he had smashed the window in a failed effort to save his children from inside the fiery inferno. His face was plastered with grime and soot, save for the stark tear tracks beneath his eyes, and his voice was completely lost from hours of anguish and unanswered cries. Of the 9 little children who had been asleep in their beds at the time the fire broke out, only 4 were accounted for. Unsure of how he was meant to proceed in a situation like this, Morrison put a call into the regional fire marshal, who had told him to search the ruins for evidence of how the blaze had started and the concern of the children had died. In terms of identifying where a live inferno had broken out, Morris had next to nothing to go on. A sobbing Jennifer Sodder had informed the police that she had heard something thrown up onto the roof of the address, which had subsequently rolled down along the roof of the fire, with the fire set near the phone box and it was being studied. The problem was, other than piles of ash and charred timber, the blaze had left little behind to inspect. Conscious that the fire department's reputation was already in tatters due to the time it had taken them to arrive, Morris was acutely aware that he had to come up with something, and decided to report faulty wiring in and around the phone box as the most likely cause. But the lack of forensic evidence was only one of the problems that the Fayetteville fire chief had to solve, as the remains he had managed to recover were barely enough to make up one human being, let alone the 5 who were missing. There were a few bone fragments, along with what might have been the remnants of internal organs, but nowhere near what there should have been. For the best part of an hour, Morris debated in his head what the best course of action was. The children were dead. There was no other logical conclusion. And to show what he had found for the family, it only caused him suffering. Gathering the meager remains into an undamaged biscuit tin, he buried them a short distance away, resolving to tell the family that the intensity of the blaze had totally destroyed the children's bodies. It was little more than small mercy, but the least he could do, given such tragic circumstances. Giorgio Sodu had been just 14 years old when he had walked through the arrivals gate at Ellis Island, possessing little more than the clothes he was wearing. Upon seeing America for the first time, his older brother had elected to return to their home in Europe, but for Giorgio, this was indeed the land of opportunity. Westernizing his name to George Sodder, the young migrant immediately set about making a life for himself in his new homeland, working his way up through a series of building companies to the point where he was finally able to set up his own haulage firm. In time, he met a shopkeeper's daughter, Jennifer Cipriani, who had similarly migrated to the United States as a child from her native Italy, and their subsequent marriage would go on to produce 10 children. Though many people would ask through the years what it was that had caused him to leave the Sardinian birthplace behind, George refused to discuss the reasons for the move, or indeed offer any detail regarding his childhood. It was only during the rise of the fascist movement during the mid-1920s that he finally began to share his opinions with friends and neighbours. Sodder was an ardent opponent of Italy's coming fascist regime, and in particular, an outspoken critic of Prime Minister Benito Mussolini. He did not hold back what he thought should become a corrupt government, and his passionate outpouring soon made him deeply unpopular with some quarters of the Italian migrant population.
The word diet involves things such as deprivation, restriction, cutting things out.
Deprivation. During October of 1965, there were a series of unsettling incidents at the Sodder residence. A visiting life insurance salesman became enraged when asked to move on from the premises, angrily declaring that the family had paid for George's previous comments about Mussolini. In another incident, a jobbing tradesman whose services the Sodders refused to employ alleged that George's wiring was so shoddy that the whole house would eventually burn down. In the run-up to the festive season, the family was unaware of a strange car that would park up and watch the younger children going to and from school. Then, at 12:30 rang unexpectedly. When Jenny answered, the female voice did not recognize that down the line before the mysterious caller hung up. Half an hour later, Jenny heard what she thought sounded like objects passing on the roof above her.